to batter.
And then Joe just motioned to someone, but I can't see that someone. Popped up to short. Rafael Bornegal makes the catch. That'll do it. The A's win it 4-1. Here's Mike with the totals.
Oh, thank you, John. A's 4-9-0, and the Yankees 1-5-1. And John's going to be back with the postgame right after these messages from True Value Hardware.
There and take a cut, don't you? We'll be back here with tonight's top 10 list and the lovely Meg Ryan. Thank you very much. Say one thing here. A lot of people are probably sitting at home thinking to themselves, well, you know, you should have gotten a base hit. You should have advanced the runner. You should have driven in the winning run. You should have got like a ground rule double or, you know, you should have put it out of the park.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Let me just say one thing to you. I'm a talk show host, all right? I'm not a Major League Baseball
right.
player. I didn't make the decision to put me into the lineup. I didn't put a gun to Joe Torre's head.
Right.
It was his call.
That's right.
I did what I could. I took a swing. I waited on a pitch. I picked one out I liked. I made contact, all right?
That's all you can
How
do.
Many of you here or in your living room sitting there full of warm beer could even get around on a 95-mile-an-hour yakker, huh?
Right. Well said.
I'm sorry. It's the heat of the contest.
I know,
did what I could. We'd have liked to won the game.
I know, of course.
Yeah. Meg Ryan is here tonight, ladies and gentlemen. The lovely comedian Meg Ryan. Lance Hendrickson from the TV program Millennium, the TV program there on Fox. Right? Mary Chapin Carpenter. Boy, is she good, Mary Chapin Carpenter. Here in my left hand is tonight's top 10 list. Let's do this. You're lucky I wasn't hit in the head, for God's sake.
Damn right.
I'm not a baseball player.
Damn right, no.
I'm a television personality. I'm just a wimp. Thank you very much, Mimi. The category tonight from the home office in Wahoo, Nebraska, top 10 things overheard at the Cannes Film Festival. Every year in the south of France, they have the big film gala, the big Cannes Film Festival. People, movie lovers from all over the world and stars show up at the big film festival. Top 10 things now overheard at the Cannes Film Festival. Here we go, number 10. Oh no, Marlon Brando is headed to the nude beach. Number 9, actually, we Americans don't know what Mr. Stallone is saying either. Number 8, and now a brand new category, lamest volcano movie. Number 7, Je m'appelle Butthead. Number 6, I'm sorry, Mr. Cern, but room service does not deliver lesbians. Number 5. Uh-oh, Jean-Claude Van Damme got drunk and kicked himself in the head. Number 4, I can't believe they gave a special jury award to that Juice Tiger infomercial. Number 3, the prize for special achievement in gay cinema goes to Batman and Robin. Number 2, look, it's Jabba the Hutt. No, it's just Roger Ebert. And the number 1 thing overheard at the Cannes Film Festival, Les Booty Calls, C'est Magnifique. Our first guest is one of the loveliest and most talented of your big-time motion picture stars. Her new film, Addicted to Love, opens May 23rd. Here she is, the always delightful Meg Ryan. Oh, Meg! How you doing? Good to see you.
How are you?
I'm fine, Meg. Thank you very much for being on the program. We always like having you here on the show.
I like coming.
Do you enjoy it, really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
At first, I was always nervous.
Well, me too. I think everybody's a little nervous at
first.
I am nervous right now.
Oh.
Yeah. I just popped out at Yankee Stadium. What have you been up to? Let's talk about your life. You've been traveling, you've been working, you had some time off. Where'd you go?
We just went around the world.
Oh, no, you didn't.
Yeah.
With whom?
With Dennis, my husband, and my little
Dennis
boy.
Quaid, yeah.
Yes.
Around the world.
Yeah.
This is like a trip of a lifetime.
Yeah. We didn't know we were going to do it. We thought we would just go to Bali and, like, sleep. Mm-hmm. But then we got all excited and we kept going.
Bali is in the South Pacific?
Yes, yeah. We ended up in India.
Mm. What is India like?
So weird. So great. We went, like, I've never been anywhere where you, like, you step off the plane and you get nervous.
Yeah.
Like, my foot hits the jetway, and I thought, will this hold? Because it was just, I saw through it to the bottom. It was so weird. And then this hotel sent this car, which was like a roller skate or something. It was this tiny little Indian car? Yeah. And this, like, Brazilian guy got in there with us, and so there's all 4 of us stuffed into this roller skate car, and we have this endless trip to the hotel. It was like 2.5 hours we had to be in this car, and you look outside and you see. Have you ever been there?
Never been to India.
Oh, well, there's like more people than I ever dreamed there were on the planet.
Yeah. Sure.
Then there was wildlife, which is weird.
Very exotic.
See, yeah, like elephants on the street.
Really?
Yeah, and we had, like, on the street, and what is that? They're screaming, what is that elephant doing there? And our driver was this sort of inexplicably cheerful man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was happy about everything.
An American from Chicago, Illinois?
So I'm screaming about this elephant. What is this elephant? What is it doing? And he says, you know, oh, he's just going.
Oh, no, you didn't tell me he was going.
Yeah, going.
That's,
right,
you know, that's even a bigger problem.
We keep going, and he has to get out of the car to make a phone call or something. So here we are in the car with this Brazilian and this thronging people. Then the car gets kind of surrounded by the funkiest-looking cows you're ever going to see.
Oh, like, cows.
And they're just milling around, no one paying any attention to them or anything. The guy gets back in the car. We say, what are these cows doing around here? What are these cows doing? He says, there's a disco here. So, and the whole time was like that. You just never knew.
It's bovine night at the disco. But was it overall, was it a good experience? Were you happy to have been able to go there?
Yeah. We were, we ended up like instantly going to London to get some Indian food.
Oh, really? You didn't eat Indian food in India?
No, we didn't try.
And when you travel like that, or whenever you go anywhere, people just must recognize you and drive you crazy, or is it not so bad? They're nice about it?
It was weird this time because I guess I'm famous over there because I did a commercial. Not in India, like in Asia.
Uh-huh.
All right. And I did this commercial for a shampoo.
Really?
Which was called Sexy Mild Shampoo.
The Sexy Mild people. That's good stuff.
Not like Sexy Wild. Sexy Mild.
Sexy Mild.
You know? And another completely mystifying commercial. They had me just dressed as a nun. Like, it was a full-on Sister Batrille outfit. And I'm walking around with a bike and smelling the shampoo kind of constantly.
Right.
And they want me to say, you know, I like to talk, and sometimes I dress. No, I like to talk, and sometimes I walk like a boy.
I don't know what that means. What
no,
is that?
I don't know.
This is in the nun's outfit.
In the nun's outfit. Yeah. Weird. You kind of can't be too bicky when you're selling out.
That's peculiar. But is this a commercial you did recently or did years ago?
Yeah, recently. Then they would give me line readings.
Mm-hmm.
So they say, "No, Meg, it's I love Sassy Mouth." Just like that?
Yeah.
They say it just like that. So,
are you selling a lot
weird.
Of shampoo for them?
I don't know, but the people like go, Sissy Mild, Sissy Mild. So I kind of have to live with it.
You know, good for you. Take what you
I
can get,
so.
For heaven's sakes.
Sell right out.
How's your husband? Is he good?
He's really good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He flies his own plane?
Yeah.
Yeah. How long has he been flying?
For like a long time.
Does he, did he fly?
20 years.
Oh, 20 years. So he flew before you knew him, probably.
Yeah, he flew when he did this movie called Right Stuff, and he started way back when. And then he would kind of take me around when he was, when I first got together with him, I would just sort of stupidly do anything. I'd go up in the single engine plane,
right.
And we'd do like a 6-hour flight to Montana in this little, like having a Volkswagen in the air.
He's like showing off for you.
Yeah, and we'd have oxygen masks and like headsets, and I had this little dog called Gus at the time who, you know when animals are really afraid and they put out that smell? They get so afraid
the smell
that they're
is actually
like
the least
shaking
of it, Meg.
And smelling. Oh. You just sit on my lap and shake.
All right, hang on one
miserable.
Second here. We got to do a commercial, and I want to hear more about you flying with Dennis Quaid. Okay. We'll be right back here with Meg Ryan. So now, your husband pilot Dennis Quaid, and you told me he's got like 2,000 hours. So this guy knows what he's doing.
You know, I don't even know. I mean, he's got thousands of hours. He kind of knows what he's doing.
Yeah, I would think so.
But I say to him, you know, I'm not going in any weather with you.
Right.
I cannot even go by a cloud.
He wants to go everywhere in the plane, right?
And he says, well, like he'll say these things like, Meg, we're going to fly through some rain, but no clouds.
Uh-huh.
And I think if I knew anything, like I feel like I can correct his driving.
Yeah.
So if I knew anything about flying, I could really be helpful.
But you can't.
No, I can't.
You're
I can
just
say, is that door closed?
Yeah. You're just along for the ride.
No, exactly.
Yeah. But where do you like go? Is it just like Sunday afternoon he takes you up?
No.
Look, there's the house. You can see the house.
He used to do that. He used to do that, but I can't do that. So now we do. Like I had to go from New York to Montana one time, and well, the bad thing was that I was reading about helicopter crashes, like, in the back of the plane, which was not good.
That's not good.
But we had to...
great literature for your in-flight entertainment.
Why I'm doing that, I don't know. And so we have to land in Cheyenne, Wyoming, in order to refuel or something. And I look up, and I see what I interpret as clouds out there.
Sure.
Black clouds and
big
purple, and there's bumping, and we finally land, and I'm thinking he's broken every promise he's ever made to me. I go into the ladies' room at this tiny little like flight service station, and I lock myself in there, and I just I start to cry.
You're just traumatized.
Traumatized,
now.
You know, horrified, and just thinking, oh, he lied to me, blah blah. And so He's forced, because I've been there for so long, he's forced to come in. And he has to kind of lean up over the stall and talk me out of there and everything. And it was like some kind of Laurel and Hardy thing, because all of a sudden the door to the ladies' room opens and all the people who worked at the flight service station were listening.
Oh.
So there's like in my, anyway, it was, I had to.
That's an FAA violation,
yeah,
by the way.
Yeah, it's never, anyway. Yeah. It should be.
Yeah, so then, but obviously you took off.
I had to get back on that plane.
You can't hang around with those folks,
right,
after that.
Right.
Yeah, and everything was fine. Then you landed and everything was okay?
Yeah, everything is always fine. but I get really flipped out about it.
Yeah. How are things in Montana? Good?
Good, yeah.
Yeah.
We have a, we have a pond that we just dug on our property.
Oh, that's nice.
And the thing about it, though, is that we have a dog called Dave.
Dog named Dave?
Yeah. And he's, Jack calls him, my son calls him Dave the dog.
Dave the dog.
We have a friend named Dave the man.
Uh-huh. Oh, I see. So this is Dave the dog.
Well, yeah, Dave the man, Dave the dog. Then one time I had a driver called, we had to call him Cowboy Dave the man. And now our pond is called Dave the Lake.
You have Dave the Lake. Oh, Lake Dave. How lovely.
No, Dave the Lake.
I know Dave the Lake.
With little sign.
How many acres of land? You get like a million square acres, don't you?
Oh,
how big
are you
a place
saying?
Is this? It's huge, isn't it? Because Montana is enormous.
It's an enormous place, but we have a little miniature part of the ecosystem.
You get a half acre?
Something like that.
Oh, it's been beautiful there, though, isn't it?
Yeah, beautiful, especially now and through the summer. It's great there.
And help me out here with my geography. Is there part of Montana that you look right into kind of Yellowstone Park, or am I
drunk? Yeah, we're very close to the park there.
What is that like? Is it just unbelievably beautiful?
Well, Dennis used to make me fly over it constantly. And so I know it very well.
Yeah.
Geography of it, but and people are always come when they come visit us. They always go to the park.
Is it a good place to have your family there? A good place for kids? Is it got to be the best, right?
It's beautiful. It's completely. It makes you feel very small, which is what's so great about it. Because the mountains are so huge and it's perfect.
Now the mountains, are we near? what are we near? It's not the Tetons, is it? They're somewhere else.
Boy, Dave.
Huh?
You know a lot about
it. Is it the Tetons?
It's near the Tetons. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know exactly the name of them, but they're some part of the Rocky Mountain Range.
Cool.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, this movie, Meg, Addicted to Love,
that's
a great title for a movie, by the way. Great title for a movie, and a great cast, you and Matthew Broderick. That's a nice combination, isn't it?
It was a lot. We had a lot of fun doing it. It's a very kind of weird movie.
It's a little bizarre, isn't it?
Yeah. It's about kind of heartbreak and espionage. Mm-hmm.
And you play a tough guy.
Kind of, yeah. Yeah, I play. She thinks she's some kind of combination of like Edie Sedgwick and Catwoman.
That's pretty good.
It's weird, but good.
Yeah, and the idea is that you and Matthew. Can I tell the idea, or we don't tell
go
the
ahead.
Idea? You and Matthew are thrown together because what you have in common is your former boyfriend girlfriend have now gotten together as a couple.
Yes, they're together, and we are now spying on them.
Mm-hmm.
And we've set up this thing. It's like a series of lenses and mirrors that projects their image from across the street because we're kind of camped out in this abandoned building across the street from them.
The camera obscure.
Yeah, and it's this camera obscure, and it will project the images of what's happening across the street onto our own wall, so we can be with them.
And Matthew just wants his girlfriend back.
Yeah, but
you
want
to kill your boyfriend.
I want to destroy him.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
I want to make him miserable.
We have a clip of the movie here.
Okay.
You know what it is?
This is when I've set up some bugging equipment over there, so all we can do is hear them, and I'm making Matthew listen.
Okay, here we go. Meg Ryan, Matthew Broderick, Addicted to Love.
Let me hear.
It's wrong, Sam.
Just for a second, I just want to hear her voice, her sweet voice.
Beg me.
Please.
Excuse me, did you say something?
Please let me hear.
Okay.
Oh my God. Oh my God, he's killing her.
Yeah, he's killing her, all right. She's loving every minute of it.
No, she's not like that. She likes to make love quiet and slow and gentle.
That girl of yours is a carnival ride.
Well, this is horrible. This is horrible. This is worse than I'd imagined.
Want me to turn it off?
No, I need to hear it.
Very brave.
Oh, God. God.
A carnival ride. A carnival ride.
Pretty nice. Opens May 23rd. What do you do now? Are you nervous and crazy because you're waiting for the movie to open, or are you happy and relaxed and comfortable? Or
well, I'm working on another one.
Yeah?
Man.
It never stops, does it?
It's insane.
Yeah. And when will this one be finished?
In July. Mm-hmm. I'll finish it up in July.
Wow. Well, good for you.
Well, thank you.
Congratulations. Give my best to Dennis.
I will.
And say hello to the great state of Montana for me.
I will.
Him.
Dave.
Tell him Dave said hello.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Meg. Nice to see you. Meg Ryan. Oh, my God, will you? Look at how fast those boats are traveling. Oh, call the Coast Guard. Our next guest is a multiple Grammy Award-winning performer who is one of the favorites here on the program. Her most recent CD is entitled The Place in the World. Look at this. It's right there. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back the very, very talented Mary Chapin Carpenter.
Every heart has got a story about love holding out alone. Baby, when you're in that lonely, you just don't want a cure. Fool you once, you are forgiven. Fool you twice, you're just a fool. You fear the future's all been written by the past and what didn't last. All the better to dream of you. Better to be this side of heaven. Believing again, some dreams come true. The better to dream of you. Every story's got a chapter, and that chapter will be defined by what's before and what comes after. Of this one is mine. Everything that came before us wore me out and weighed me down. You raised me up like a gospel chorus, a rock steady on solid ground. The better to dream of you, the better to be this side of heaven. Believing again, some dreams come true. The better to dream of you.
Like an old time tent revival, I felt my heart come back alive. No preacher, baby, no Bible, just this love to testify. Yeah. All the better to dream of you, the better to be this side of heaven. Believing again, some dreams come true. The better to dream of you, better to dream of you. Yeah, stranger things that might have happened. Believing again, some dreams come true. The better to dream of you, better to dream of you. The better to be this side of heaven. Believing again, some dreams come true. The better to dream of you.
Good to see you again. How you been? All right?
Thanks.
Everything good? Do you know that guy?
Yeah.
Could you pick him out of a lineup?
Yeah.
Mary Chapin Carpenter, kids. We'll be right back.
next guest has made over 50 films from Dog Day Afternoon to The Terminator, and now he stars as Frank Black on the critically acclaimed television series Millennium. Here he is, Lance Hendrickson. Oh, Lance! Good to see you. Welcome to the program, Millennium. Tell the folks what Millennium is, or maybe not have seen it before. What do you guys do in Millennium?
We kind of hunt down serial killers.
Wow. Are you a government agency? Is it just enthusiasts? Is it?
There is a real group called my mind is completely gone right now.
What happened?
Just the excitement of coming out here.
is that right? Yeah. Maybe that's what happened to the audience.
What are these?
Yeah, you're right.
Yours or mine?
No, mine. No. I'm not talking about yours. I'm talking about mine.
No, they're called the... Forget it.
What's the matter? You all right?
Yeah. Right. It's a good group.
Let's start somewhere else. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? Where are you from originally?
New York.
Mm-hmm. New York. Grew up here. How old were you when you left?
About 12.
12. And you had a very colorful life, didn't you? A very colorful early life?
Yes, I did. I left New York after I realized you had to pay like a buck a piece for oranges. And time to go somewhere else. Yeah.
Did you get into trouble as a kid?
A little bit.
Where did you go when you left New York?
I went west. Yeah. That was still the calling back in the 40s.
Talking about New Jersey?
Yeah.
What kind of trouble did you get into?
I got picked up for vagrancy a lot because I hitchhiked across country.
You're a kid and you're hitchhiking across the country?
Yeah.
And you get picked up for vagrancy. That means, of course, you have no money at all on you? Yeah.
A lot of things had to do with economics when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. We were broke. So, but anyhow, when I got to Tucson, they threw me in jail. For vagrancy, and Lee Marvin came into that jail to play The Life of Ira Hayes, and I asked him to get me out, but he wouldn't. Yeah. They just went on.
Oh darn! I thought maybe.
But that was the first my first connection to acting.
Uh-huh. But
why is that funny?
You were also in a film when you were behind bars, right?
Yeah. They paid me $5 to be an extra. Uh-huh. So somewhere out there in an archive somewhere is me marching with 50 other guys in there for vagrancy, you know.
So in the background is a shot of you actually in jail with other actual prisoners.
Yeah.
And then you were sailed with a merchant marine?
Yeah, I used that as a way of... I never knew my father very well, so I got on ships to find out what kind of guy he was, and then I ended up in Europe.
Your father had been in the Merchant Marine as well?
His
been a sailor?
Life. Yeah.
And what sort of things did you do when you were on ship?
Well, I was like a floating bum, kind of. Yeah. That's what it was like.
Did you get paid to travel that way?
$60 a month or something.
Yeah. And a tough, difficult life to be on...
Very easy. I mean, very boring. I mean, just standing wheel watches and all that kind of thing. Uh-huh. But when I got to Europe, I traveled Europe painting murals, so it was kind of...
You're an artist as well, then?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For whom would you paint murals? Like, not the Sistine Chapel, we're not talking about that kind of stuff, are we?
I had aspirations of that, but that was about it.
Just drop by, see if they need any touch-up work. you're peeling a little bit. I can take that down.
They I used to con people into it so that I could, you know, do it in restaurants and get a meal. At one point, I was staying at a guy's house and painted a mural of him because he was an alcoholic, and I was gonna... When you're young, you have delusions that you can change the world. Mm-hmm. So I painted him rotting in a gutter, and it was huge. And then he ran me off, me out. So
you had a very exciting life for a young man, very worldly experiences.
Yeah.
And then you come back, and you were in Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
Dog Day was my first.
That was your first film.
Yeah. And then Close Encounters, and then... And that wasn't a very good experience. I mean, I made about $1,500 a week for 6 months, and I got to hang out with Truffaut. But every idea that I had, Spielberg was always looking at me like I was doing something wrong. Like I wanted to throw my jacket over the little guys and run them into a porta potty or something.
You're talking about...
And he didn't go for that, you know.
But you know, as an extra, you're not really paid for your ideas.
Well, I wasn't really. I turned out I was an extra, but I actually had a couple of lines. You know,
I see.
Was
like,
yeah.
And Dog Day Afternoon, that must have been a big, big thrill for you, huh?
It was, yeah. I knew all those people, you know, from being in New York. So it was big, big deal.
Yeah. Okay, now let's get back to Millennium. You and the folks are out there looking for serial killers.
There's a lot of categories of that. Uh-huh. I mean, that's some of it. Some of it is just unsolvable cases, you know, that you look back on.
It's not like the unsolved mysteries, though. This is
a whole different deal.
Yeah.
No, this is... These are... Why is it I can't talk about myself? I mean,
I don't know.
I know you don't know, but
I got an idea.
The show kind of speaks to
You're uncomfortable in this form. You're just a little uncomfortable in this. You're what?
I'm comfortable.
You're comfortable.
Yeah.
Well, then I got no ideas. I thought maybe you were uncomfortable, but if you're comfortable, then hell, I don't know. You think if you were comfortable, that's half the battle.
No, the show speaks for itself.
Yeah.
It's kind of
good.
Mystery.
Good. And it's doing very well, isn't it?
It is. Yeah.
It's on right after The X-Files? Is that how they've got this now, or did they change
it? No, we're on Friday nights. Mm-hmm. We bumped The X-Files to Sunday, I guess.
I see. Yeah, it's good.
Great show.
Well, pleasure to meet
you. They wrote it for me.
Yeah, well, that's nice. Good. Thank you very much, Lance. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen. Folks know that our very own Leonard Tepper. Leonard's been on the show many, many times over the years. Leonard has a brand new show right here on CBS in the fall, and if we can, we'd like to give everybody an idea what the show is going to be like. Do me a favor, folks. Say hello to our good friend Leonard Tepper. Leonard, come on out. Here he is, Leonard Tepper.
Hi, Mr. Leonard.
Have a seat. Thank you, Leonard. Boy, Leonard, congratulations on your new show. By the way, did you see Meg Ryan?
Oh, yeah.
Did you say hello to Meg?
Oh, yeah.
You didn't bother her, did you?
No.
All right, when she comes back, stay away from her.
Okay.
Now, the show, Leonard, it's like the old Alan Funt candid camera show. Is that what it is?
Yeah.
You take a camera out on the street, and you create artificial situations, and then you just watch the human behavior. You just kind of watch how people react to the situations you've created. Is that what you did? You just stole the idea of candid camera.
Right.
And last week, you were shooting for the show out in Denver, the Mile High City?
Right.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to show you a clip from the upcoming Leonard Tepper Hidden Video Program. Roll it.
Today, I asked people in Denver's Civic Center Plaza for directions. Here's what happened. Do you know the way to Coors Field? Well, I don't need directions, you jackass. I already got a map. Look at the hidden camera.
That's good. When is the show coming on? In the fall sometime?
In the fall sometime.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Thursday nights? Be nice. We can use a little help on Thursday nights.
Yeah.
Right in there around 10 o'clock? Looks like a 10 o'clock show to me.
Right.
Is it an hour, Leonard?
Yes.
Oh,
yes,
great.
Yes.
Tomorrow on the program, Barbara Walters will be here. I like that Barbara Walters. I got a lot of stuff I want to get all over her about. Barbara Walters will be here tomorrow. Super 8 Motels National Bed-Making Champion Ida Doggett will be here. Yeah. And gospel singer Kirk Franklin. That's the big program tomorrow night. Leonard, do you want to take another look at a clip?
Oh, let's do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, another scene from Leonard Tepper's hidden video. Roll it!
Today, I asked Denver pedestrians to take my picture. Here's what happened. Would you take my picture in Larimer Square? You can't take my picture, you moron. There's no film. Look at the hidden camera.
You have one of those shirts in every color? Is that what it is?
Oh,
you have like
it?
Dozens of them, each in a different color?
Right.
It's a good look. Stay with it.
Okay.
We'll be right back with Lance Hendrickson.